So, I hope you enjoyed the keynote and already grabbed some coffee. So my name is Petra, and today we're going to talk about execution context. So let's start by looking what was the motivation for the talk. So why do we need an execution context every time we use a future in our code? And the things that we will discuss is we start by looking at concurrency in general really quick and concurrency on the JVM. Then we'll take a quick look at the concepts available in Scala and the way of a future. So how do we actually get from using future apply to runnable? And we'll take a look at Scala's global execution context. And in the end, we take a quick look at alternatives and possible optimizations. So let's start by looking at asynchrony in general. So when we take a step back and look at real life, asynchrony is something that's actually much more natural than synchrony. We as humans hardly ever wait. So we are experts in context switching. Whenever we don't make progress on something, we immediately switch to something else, even if it's just in our thoughts. And some terms that usually come up when you talk about concurrency are also the related terms parallelism and asynchrony. And let's take a quick look at what's the difference between them. So concurrency actually doesn't mean that things happen in parallel at the same point in time. So when we take a look at those three tasks, although all of them are running at one single point in time, only one of them is active. So you could compare that to being a single person working on three things or having one CPU and working on multiple tasks. So even though we have only one person or CPU doing work, we can work on multiple things concurrently. So why does that still make sense? So it doesn't necessarily mean that all of the tasks will be finished faster, but it's still quite useful, especially in terms of usability. So just imagine when you start one operation on your PC, you wouldn't be able to do something else. So you click something and your mouse stops moving or something like that. That's rather frustrating. So even though concurrency doesn't mean necessarily the things will be done faster, it's a much nicer use experience. And when we go back to the previous example, in real life, actually, in most of the time, it will go faster because maybe the gray areas, our task would have been blocked anyway. So when we would have waited for A to complete and then only started B, that would be quite inefficient. So whenever you have blocking waiting times, then concurrency can be quite beneficial. Okay, so parallelism, on the other hand, really means that multiple things are active at the same time. And in order to do that, it's quite natural that, or easy to understand, that you need to have multiple CPUs. And a common pattern is also to split one task that is actually quite big into subtasks that can be processed in parallel. The last term that I want to talk about is asynchrony. So asynchrony isn't necessarily meaning that something is running in parallel or concurrently. It simply means that you don't actively wait for your operation to finish before you start doing something new. So on the left side, the opposite of asynchronous operations would be synchronous operations. So in that case, we start one task and then actively wait for it to finish before we do something new. While on the right side, you can see we start three tasks and then all of them complete in a random order. So in order to do that, we often need to somehow be notified when the operation is actually finished. And that is often implemented using callbacks. And it's also something that you will see when we talk about futures. So let's take a quick look at concurrency on the JVM. The thing most of you probably know for a long time are threads. So I think threads is the most low-level concept that you will probably use yourself when working with concurrent code. And while it's at the first time or in the first moment, it seems quite easy to use. So it's quite simple to start a new thread. It has a couple of downsides. That's first of all that you tightly couple your execution logic with the implementation logic. And being rather low level, it tends to be quite complex and can lead to errors easily. And the creation of threads is actually quite expensive because all of them need some memory. And when you create too much of them, your application will not only become slower, but it will eventually fail with an out of memory error, and then, yeah, it's gone. So it's not only slower, it's really dead. And so one thing that you can improve is to decouple the logic that we want to execute from the way how we want to execute it. And for that reason, a couple of concepts were introduced in Java, and it's runnable and callable, and execute and executor. So I think we have, yeah, we have dedicated slides for them, so let's switch to them. So runnable and callable are interfaces in Java. That means we use them to describe async pieces of code without really specifying how we want to run them. And those interfaces come with a single parameterless method, and also in the case of runnable, no result is returned, while callables can return a result. So since those two interfaces are only describing what we want to do, we need to have a way to specify how those things should be run. And that's what executor and executor service are for. So those are actually responsible to take a runnable and then accept, decide how those things should be executed. So it's responsible for deciding if and when new threads should be created. So when we start an asynchronous operation, we need to have some way of actually knowing when it's done or getting a result out of it. And for that, the first thing that Java provided was Java util concurrent future. You shouldn't confuse that with the Scala future because it's actually pretty different. So you don't have all the nice things that you're probably used to. You can't map on it. Basically, all you can do is poll it and see if it's completed yet. For that reason, I think in Java 8, completable future was introduced. That's quite similar to what you're used to in Scala. While it still haven't the same set of features, it at least provides to a way to describe what should be done with the result once it becomes available without blocking and waiting for it to be available before you can do that. So let's look in comparison what Scala provides us. In Scala, you will probably know those four traits or classes, and the first of them is future. So future is basically a placeholder for an object or a value that's not available yet and that might become available at some point in time. And what's important is that it's not the actual operation itself. So when we look at it, so it's only a read-only container, actually, so you can't write anything in it. We will see later what's the counterpart for doing that. And it holds a value of type T. And as I've said, that value might become available at some point in time, or if something goes wrong, the future will contain the throwable. It also offers some methods so you can work with that value. and the most known are probably MAP and FlatMAP. And futures are eager, and that means as soon as you create a future, the computation that you pass to the future will be scheduled to be run. That's a different to some other frameworks that are available. I don't know if some of you might know Monex, where tasks are actually created lazily and nothing happens until you really explicitly say, now run. So futures take a by-name parameter. That's also something that's important, because a by-name parameter means that parameter is not evaluated until you really use it. And if that wasn't a by-name parameter, then the operation that we pass to our future would be evaluated immediately. And that would somehow destroy the point of creating futures at all, because we want to actually run that expression that we pass to the future. We want to schedule that on the execution context. So also, just to stress that point again, so that the future is really just the result of the computation, and it's not the computation itself. So when you look at the apply method for future, even though you pass in some operation to execute, you could read that line as create a placeholder that may contain the result of the given expression, and not create a future that contains the operation. So since I've said that future is a read-only container, you might be wondering, how can we actually create a future? So there's a couple of ways to get a future. And one of them is, if you already have a future, you can create a new future by transforming the first one. So you can use methods like map or flatmap. And there's also a couple of factory methods provided on the future object. So you can create futures that are already completed by using future successful, or also futures that never complete. You can create new futures by using future apply and passing in an operation that will be scheduled to be run on the execution context. Or you can use promise to fulfill a future and create one. So let's have a quick look at promise. So promise is basically the counterpart to a future. So while future is the read-only container, the promise is actually the writable single assignment container. And it is able to complete a future with that value. So in the Scala library, you will find three concrete implementations of promise. Two of them are actually kept promises. So that means that when you create such a promise, it will already be fulfilled, and it can be either successful or failed. And for promises that are not completed yet, those are implemented in a default promise. And default promise extends atomic reference to store the value that will be there eventually. So let's have a quick look at how we can use promise to complete a future. I hope that's big enough even to read at the back. How is that useful? So if you look at the first method, we can, even if that example doesn't make a lot of sense, you should see how promises can be used. So we can create a promise, and then we might start off an asynchronous operation. And while that operation is still running, we can return the future of the promise to the caller immediately. And then at some other point in our code, we can use that promise instance to complete the future that we have already returned to the caller. So when we now go back to the slide where we looked at how we can create a future, actually the first three ways that I've mentioned is also implemented using promise when you have a look at it in the source code. Another interesting concept is awaitables. So even though in most cases, you just should try to avoid blocking, sometimes you might need to actively block on your current thread until a future is completed. And in that case, you can use the two methods, await ready and await result. Those methods also accept timeouts, so you probably don't want to wait forever. And the implementation of those methods is actually on the concrete promise implementations. So when we take a look at cap promise, because it's already fulfilled, we can return the result immediately. And the default premise actually tries to wait for the result. Now let's take a look at execution context finally. So what is the execution context and what do we need it for? The execution context itself is actually only a small extension to the Java interface of executor. So in addition to provide a way to execute the runnables, it also provides a failure reporting functionalities. And like its Java counterpart, it's used to, so you pass it a runnable and then the execution context will actually decide how that will be mapped to a concrete thread. So let's take a look at some of the, what you could call JVM concurrency laws. So no matter what high-level concepts you're using, it all comes down to runnable run eventually. And we can do nothing about it law. And future actually helps us and hides that complexity from us. But the point is, when you create and use futures, there is no magic to do something else. Down in the Scala implementation, when you have a look at the source code, the future will eventually be translated to a runnable, and that runnable will be executed on the execution context that you pass to your future. Yeah, like this. So, quick reminder, so the future contains the result of the operation, and the execution context actually decides how that operation will be executed. Usually that's done by using an underlying thread pool, but it's also possible to have special purpose execution contexts that might not even run the operation asynchronous at all. So as I've already mentioned, when we use future apply, that will eventually be translated to a runnable that will be scheduled on our execution context. So let's have a look how we actually get from using future apply to running on an execution context. When we type this in our REPL or have a file with that expression and we try to run it, the first thing that you will notice is that you will actually get an error. So the Scala compiler will complain that it cannot find an implicit execution context to execute that operation that you've passed to the future. So that already tells us that when we use future apply, in the back, something happens asynchronously. So we can take a look at future apply. Oops, no internet. So the first syntax that you're seeing is actually syntactic sugar for calling future apply, like you can see in the middle. Passing it 2+3. And the implementation of apply, as you can see at the bottom, is actually done using a unit map and passing it the operation that you pass to the future. So let's have a look at that more closely. Let's start by looking at the unit part. The unit is actually future.unit. And when we take a look at the implementation and follow it, down to the end, you will see that future unit is a cap promise containing the result as success with, in that case, unit. So it's basically a future that is already completed. Now let's take a look at the map part. map is implemented using a transform. And if we follow that further, we will see that transform is implemented on the promise implementation. And that's where things starting to get interesting. So when we have a look at that, we can see something that I've shown briefly before in the example when we talked about promise. That was that we can create a new promise here, as you can see. And then the future of the promise is returned immediately to the caller. That's why when you create a new future, you don't have to wait until the operation is finished. You get back a future immediately. And at the same time, when we return that future, we also call onComplete on the promise itself. And since we're currently looking at the kept promise, if you remember, a unit was a kept promise. So we have to look at the onComplete implementation on kept promise. And when we take a look at that, we will see that in the onComplete method, we create a runnable. That's where things are really getting down to the JVM concurrency stuff. So we create a new runnable and pass it the callback that we create up in our transform method. And we also pass it our execution context. And then we say execute with value. And result that you can see here is the result of the current promise, so that's the kept promise. So that's the result is simply success unit in that case. And that leads us to the one other law of JVM concurrency. And that's actually that runnable run is taking no parameters and returns nothing. So you might be wondering, how do we get data in and out of that? And the way to do it usually is that the input and the output need to be stored on the runnable itself. And that's exactly what we're doing here. So when we take a look at what execute with value is doing, execute with value is simply storing the value that we're passing it in a variable on the callback runnable itself. And then it uses execute to execute to basically execute it, run itself on the given executor. And that executor will be calling the runnable run method. And inside that method, we have then access to the value that we first stored on the runnable itself. And then we can call, try to call our onComplete method with that value. And the onComplete method was defined in the transform method before. So this F result is actually the operation that we've seen at the very beginning. So we're passing to that function simply unit, which doesn't matter much in our example. So it's calling basically tmap with that function, and in that function we will pass unit to it. So we're not doing anything with the parameter. So in that case we will simply execute a 2+3 on the new thread, and when that completes, we will try to complete the promise with it, as we have seen here, right? So this is the callback that we are executing. And then we try to complete P. So P is our new promise, the future that we return to the caller. And onComplete is called on the already fulfilled promise. So in that case, because it's already fulfilled, onComplete will schedule the given runnable immediately. And then we will complete the promise or the future that was returned to the caller with the result of the operation that we initially passed to our future. there are any questions, you can also ask during the talk, just by the way. So to sum it up, the example, the expression that we pass to future apply gets scheduled on the execution context that you also pass to it. And future apply is actually implemented using future unit map. That's a nice way of consistency, I think. So there is really not a big difference between calling map on another future and creating a future. We will have a short example to see the small difference that actually exists. And it's implemented on promise. And when the current promise completes, which is already the cut promise in the example that we've seen, we execute the given expression on the execution context. I'm not sure if we lost some time with that problem. So I think we need to skip the second example. But just as a reminder, as we've seen, when you use future apply, the value that you pass to it or the operation will actually be scheduled on your execution context. And for that reason, you should never use future apply to wrap already available values in the future. Instead of doing that, you can use the factory methods future successful or future failed. And that will skip all the overhead of scheduling the expression on the execution context. Just to show you that example really quickly, you can have a look at the slides after the talk. That would have been what actually is the difference when we call map on a real future, so on one that is not completed yet. And the difference is that in that case, our future might not be completed yet, so we can't run the callback immediately. And for that reason, we are storing the callback in a list. And as soon as the promise is actually completed, we can go through that list and execute the callback as we've seen in the previous example. The third case that I haven't mentioned at all, because it's the most complicated of all three, is when you call actually flatmap. So that means that the operation that you pass to your future or to map or flatmap in that case is in turn creating a new future or a new default promise. And that's actually a very interesting case, but would probably be a talk of its own. So in that case, our result is another default promise, and we somehow have to link them together. So you can only, basically, we all link them back together to the root promise, and when that finishes executing, we can then call the other callbacks. So let's have a really quick look at execution context global. It's a quite good general purpose execution context. So when you're in doubt, it's usually a good idea to use the standard execution context. It's backed by a Java fork point pool. And that fork join pool basically tries to keep your CPU busy. That means when there is one task that is not doing actual work, but it's blocked, it might spin up another thread that basically compensates for the thread that's currently blocked and not doing actual work. So there are some ways to configure the execution context. The default configuration assumes to create a maximum number of the CPUs that are available. And like I said, in case of blocking, it will still spin up additional threads. And you can still you can also configure that number per default. It's 256. And some things that you have to care about is, or keep in mind, is that your applications, when you develop locally and you don't set that configuration properties explicitly, it will use the number of CPUs available on your laptop. So it might behave differently when you then run it on a server. Also, until Java 10 getting the number of available processes didn't work really well in Docker containers. So in that case, it was especially important to manually configure the number of available CPUs. And when you're using multiple execution contexts in your code, it might also make sense to adapt the number because clearly not all of them can use all CPUs of your system. So something that's, I think, really cool about the global execution context is this support for blocking. So while blocking still is bad because it those threads can't be used to perform other tasks while they are blocked, the global execution context at least gives us a way of notify the execution context that a thread is about to block, and then it can do something about it. Because when you don't have something like that, let's assume you have a thread pool with a fixed number of two threads, you can easily run into deadlocks as well. So in that case, task one and task two are running on threads at the moment. And maybe task one is waiting for task four that's still in the queue waiting to be scheduled because there's no free thread. And task two is waiting for task three that's also in the queue. Then you already have a deadlock because the tasks that are currently blocking your threads will never get the result that they are waiting for. So the global execution context provides something called the block context, and it basically notifies the execution context that your current thread is about to block. And in that case, when we look back, the execution context would be smart enough to say, okay, task one and task two are not doing any actual work at the moment, so we can spin up other threads to compensate for the threads that are not doing any work. So let's have a look at an example, if that really makes a difference. If we look at the first example where we don't use the block context and we have a slow operation that is every time it's called, it's for some reason it's blocking 80 milliseconds. And when we called it 100 times, it should be no big surprise that would usually take 8 seconds. But because my laptop has four actual CPUs, which is reported as 8 CPUs. To Java, you can cut that number, you can divide it by 8. So we basically get down to running one operation per second. Also, something that's interesting is when you look at the log output, you can actually see that the execution context has created 8 different threads. So in that case, the number here on the left, or here on the right, wherever you want to look, actually goes from 15 up to 22. So you can see it has created 8 different threads in that case. And when we run the same operation again, but this time we wrap our blocking code in the block context, we will see that when we do that, when you run it 100 times, we will now actually have almost 7 operations per second. And why is that? Because as we've seen before, in that case, whenever the execution context encounters some piece in your code where you have said, okay, now my thread is about, my code is about to block, it will spin up additional threads. So in that case, we can see that it has created a lot more threads. That doesn't mean that there is more than 3,000 active threads. So the number is just so high because I've run the example several times. But because that number is still limited by that configuration option, so it will never create more than 256 per default. In our previous example, it would have probably created about, I guess, it should still be able to do it with 10. So every time it encounters the blocking code block, it would have created a new thread. But whenever that thread is finally completed after 80 milliseconds, it would be able to shut down that thread. So you don't have to worry that it would start up 3,000 threads in that case. Let's look at some alternatives in the last couple of minutes. So while the global execution context is usually a good idea to use, you're free to basically create an execution context from every Java executor out there. So there is a method on execution context that allows you to do that. You can actually also create an execution context from an executor service. And in addition, there are other libraries like Monix or Scala-C that provide alternative implementations that are then often called task and also provide custom execution context. And so one example, what's the difference is that for tasks are basically lazy. That means unlike futures where we have seen when we pass that operation to future apply, and it gets immediately scheduled on the execution context. And with task, you can still create your asynchronous, you can define your operations, but nothing will happen. So the task doesn't immediately need an execution context for that reason. It only needs one when you then call explicitly run, which says, okay, now let's schedule that piece of work on the execution context. In some cases, this gives you a little bit finer control about where you want to put your async boundaries in your code. That basically means when do you really want to have to start working on a new thread? Because for some very small operations, so switching threads also comes with an overhead. So sometimes it might be beneficial if the operation is really small and you're completely sure it's not about to block. You might want to control it. You can say, okay, I want to batch and run a number of small operations on the same thread. Yeah, exactly. So that was what I mentioned down below just. And another thing that you should keep in mind is that you shouldn't mix too much regarding what kind of operations you're running on your execution context. So in case you're doing a lot of long running and blocking I/O operations, it might be a good idea to have a dedicated execution context for that work so that your other work that is actually doing computations and no blocking isn't basically doesn't have to wait or doesn't have to share the number of threads with the other tasks that are blocking for a long time. Cool, so we have, I think, 2 minutes left. That should be enough to sum it up really quickly. So the execution context is basically the piece of code that is responsible to decide how that operation that you're passing to the future will be run on a thread. And when you use futures, it will in the back it will create a callback runnable, and that callback runnable will be scheduled on a provided execution context. And Scala's global execution context is backed by a Java fork join pool. And as I said, something I think that's really important and often is not such a well-known feature is the actual support for blocking. So you might really want to have a look at that. And yeah, I think that's basically it. I think we have 1 minute or two for questions. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Petra. We actually have only 1 minute, but it's coffee break time now. So if there are urgent questions, we can ask them now, and maybe you will be out there for coffee break,
yeah, sure.
And then you have more. So is there anyone who wants to ask directly? Yeah. I come over there as well.
Thank you for the talk. So my question was, you mentioned went into depth for the standard library, and you mentioned Monix and Scala Set, but what's about Twitter futures? What's the difference there? And could you,
I have to say that I haven't used them that much. I'm not sure if they are actually that often in use anymore. Maybe Victor can, I see him sitting there in the front row. Maybe he has an opinion on that.
So what I would say is, I think the Twitter features are mainly used within the Twitter stack. So I guess from what I recall, since we did collaborate on standardizing futures. I think they do support cross conversions between Scala futures and Twitter futures. I think the main difference that I see is that Twitter futures are cancelable, so there's bidirectional communications for those. But I'm definitely not an expert in the Twitter future implementation.
So I think we take one more question, and the rest probably best better one on one.
I wonder, what is the penalty of using futures? So you had one example with this support for blocking context, where you showed like usually it would take 8 seconds, but then with blocking context, it was like 7 times faster. I would have thought it would be like 100 times faster. Could you, do you know why it's like only this small performance benefit?
So first of all, I think it would have taken 1 second because of the 8 CPUs, that's what it cut in half already a bit. And, but yes, it was about 7 times faster. And I think the reason for this, that is, still has to, so it has to wait for the 80 milliseconds somewhere, to return the result of the given, of summing up the two numbers. So if that operation takes 80 milliseconds, you can't be unlimited fast.